Welcome to Nintendo Voice Chat
there it
for the
is.
Week
welcome.
Of
welcome.
July 7th, 2016. I'm Jose Otero. To my left is Brian Altano.
Mm-hmm.
To my right is Per Schneider.
Hello.
And to his right is Samuel Claiborne.
Hey, everybody.
So.
Hey, listen.
It's an interesting year because it's not just 2016. IGN turns 20 this year. I'm not sure if you guys know. But
we're ancient.
We're ancient. He's ancient. And on September 29th, the site was launched. Pear was here since day one. That's quite an accomplishment. I mean, that deserves a round of applause. Just that's an amazing feat.
Thank you.
In this business,
age deserves an
and age wins.
Thank you.
So 2016 was also the 20th anniversary of the Nintendo 64, which is very much intertwined with the site as a whole. Pretty much, that was also the heyday era for Nintendo, right?
Yeah, and the idea was, I mean, N64.com launched on the day the N64 came out. So, you know, it wasn't by coincidence that IGN launched the same day, obviously, right?
Oh,
that was one of the
you planned it.
That was the first big major North American system launch that IGN was online for. And then obviously we had like Saturn World, PlayStation, PSX Power, a couple of websites. Next Generation, you guys remember that magazine? So yeah, we created the online version of that, Next Gen Online and Next Generation Online. And so yeah, that's when it all started for us. So we had this special relationship with the N64 from the very beginning.
So we thought, because these stars have aligned and it's the 20th anniversary, we should talk a little bit about the Nintendo 64 before we move on to a really fun audience participation bit where you guys are going to help us draw up the top 10 Nintendo 64 games. So keep that in the back of your mind while you're listening to the show.
Remember them.
Or listening to us. Yeah, please.
IGN is officially tired of writing its own lists,
yeah.
And we are now crowdsourcing them.
Yeah, and I'm going to try and get this list published on the site with blurbs written by our writers, but it will still have come from here. And so we will really appreciate your help.
If it's bad, we're all going to leave really nasty comments, just so you guys know.
Yeah, yeah, we tend to do that from time to time.
That's a good role reversal. The audience writes a list and the IGN editors leave the comments.
Worst list.
So let's talk about the Nintendo 64, right? I mean, again, launches 1996. Went on to lifetime sales, 32 million units, 224 million units of software. But more importantly, this is not going to be a super detailed history because we want to keep you guys awake for this part. So we're just going to talk briefly about the Nintendo 64. Apparently, Time Magazine called it the Nintendo 64 was the machine of the year in 1996. Did anybody know that?
Really? Yeah, and it was 1996 was the year NASA launched a machine into space to land on a freaking asteroid. So thanks, Time.
Did it play Mario 64? No, it did,
it
not.
Did not.
So the N64
right. Yes.
Wins.
Yeah.
Suck it, NASA.
But yeah, there was a lot of hyperbole when the system launched, I think, from the mainstream press, because I think they could wrap their mind around what this machine was, right? Like, with the PlayStation, nobody knew what Sony was doing. Like, these guys make TVs. Why are they making a console? With Nintendo, everybody got it. Everybody yeah. knew Nintendo. And you looked at the machine, you're like, oh, it's a Super NES, but the cart goes here and the, you know.
But the excitement.
But it was on the heels of a flop that was nothing like that. So the Nintendo 64 is returning to things that were more like that. Because the Virtual Boy was as far as you could get from the systems they had been making.
Do you think anybody noticed that came out, though? Like,
I don't think
Time Magazine, do you think
I bought it.
They
got
noticed?
The whole launch lineup. Nestor's
you did?
Monkey Bowling.
Really?
Oh, you did
You
that?
Bought it at launch?
Yeah, I bought it at launch.
Do you still have it?
It was the worst Christmas. yeah, I still have my one, but one eye is out now, so it's just a
your
regular
blind. Eye or the yeah no it destroyed eyes.
I didn't know that. So there was a lot of hype though still because it was Nintendo's next home console, which the Virtual Boy kind of wasn't, and the code name was Project Reality, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and that set off hype alone, but then it was introduced as the Ultra 64, right?
Yeah, and then you know Nintendo I think got cold feet because it was really hard to say in Japanese, right? Like it's Urutora 64, and they changed it to Nintendo 64. They obviously wanted their brand in there as well. But there was always this mystery around Project Reality and what it would mean. And you know, just like now, when you guys are all speculating about what the NX is going to be, and you're really excited, we were super excited about the machine. We're like, oh man, it's gonna have CDs this size, and like you know, you were just you just kind of. You ran wild with the ideas, and then, I mean, let's face it, it was another Super NES, right?
Well, and there was the Silicon Graphics thing, right, where
oh, yeah.
they were partnered with, I mean, this what was Silicon Graphics for people who did not know?
Yeah, and they showed a lot of rendered cutscenes, right? This is what SGI graphics systems can produce, right? And it was these pre-rendered movies. You're like, oh my God, looks like real life, only it doesn't. and then, you know, everybody had really high expectations as to what the games would look like. Obviously, we all love N64 games, and some of them looked really good for the time, but they did not look like, you know, pre-rendered
What are you talking about? Pierce Brosnan in the movie GoldenEye 007 totally had rectangular hands.
Like just blocks.
He's a pretty boxy man.
I want to hear Sam and Brian, just your hype stories a little bit. Like, what were you guys thinking as you were reading this
stuff? Well, I was reading IGN 64.
I was too, yeah. I was like, someday I'm going to work there.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, the hype for me for the Nintendo 64 only came after I was already reading about it on the internet, and it was really that the first round of games was just Mario 64 for me, and I just played, you know, and thought about that all the time. But man, it got really quiet after that, and I remember the hype for the system was nothing compared to the hype for games coming out.
Ah.
And there was years of waits and you know, booms and busts and great games.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
Brian,
there were like waiting for games almost immediately after the first day.
Yeah, exactly.
Like we got games the first day, and we're like, awesome, great. What's next? And they're like, well, what about Mortal Kombat Trilogy? And like, well, I don't know if that's why I bought an N64.
It made me play so many like games for a long time, though, like Pilot Wings.
Yeah, I think 100% Pilot Wings. So it actually took me a few days to play my N64 because when I first bought it, I forgot to buy an RF switch for my TV, which is a thing you had to do back then. So if
how
you don't
old were
know,
you? Hold on a second. How old were you?
This was I was probably 16 or 17.
Aww.
Yeah,
like we were 15.
Long hair.
I look totally long hair. You know, just now I think I looked exactly the same. just younger and scrappier.
Just like
and
half the size, like the
with a longer rap sheet. I went and bought a N64, and the N64 was special to me because it was the first system I ever like actually saved up for. Like, because when you're a kid, you get video game systems for free, or your parents are like, if you mow the lawn, you can get a Super Nintendo. And you're like, I don't understand how to value money. N64 was expensive, and you had to buy extra controllers with it, or you didn't, but you did anyway, because you thought you did.
Yeah.
Even though there were no four-player games at launch. So I went and bought multiple memory packs. I got four different colored controllers. I got an N64, Mario 64, Pilot Wings, and everything. Brought it all home, plugged it in my TV, turned on the TV, and heard, ding, 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 ding. Hee-hee. And Mario starts talking. I'm like, oh my God.
Where's the picture?
I can't see him. And I realized it was impossible to actually see him because I didn't have the right connectors. Now, I was living in New Jersey, and New Jersey had a thing called the Blue Law, which means stores were closed on Sundays. Oh. If you live in New Jersey, that's the least of your problems. number one is the smell. We couldn't actually go and buy anything to hook up my N64 for a good 48 hours because Monday I had school and I wasn't playing hooky and staying home and listening to Mario all day. So I didn't get to go to Toys R Us until Monday night, and that's when I actually got to play my N64 for the first time, although I did try to play just with sound for the longest time. And so that was 48 full hours of having 64 bits of power that were completely useless to me.
You know, back to the hype thing, I remember the most important thing about the Nintendo 64 is that you could walk into a Toys R Us or a Best Buy, and there was always a demo station, and people had gotten, you know, progressively further in Mario 64.
So, can I talk on that real quick? Because, that was my first time interacting with real-life spoiler culture, because
totally.
I saw out of the corner of my eye Mario picking up Bowser, spinning him in a circle, and throwing him somewhere, and I was like, I can't
you
see
didn't
this
want
right
to know.
Now. I can't look. And I walked through the Toys R Us like this.
16-year-old Brian walking, covering his eyes.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure the security guards were following me anyway.
See, my kids don't care about spoilers. You can tell them the ending to a movie, they're like, awesome!
Really?
It doesn't matter, yeah.
Is that a new generation thing?
I think it's a new thing. I remember, so when I got the machine, I actually got it a couple of days early because stores broke the street date when the N64 came out. Like, you could go to Toys R Us and they're like, yeah, sure, you can have it, right? Like, they didn't know. And so I walked home and I was super excited to plop in Mario 64. Everything worked beautifully, thank you very much. And I was just trying to share my excitement. Didn't have kids back then, right? And plugged the thing
didn't
in, was all
share.
Alone. Showed it to my wife and she's like, ah, that's nice. I'm like, no, you got, look, the polygons, they don't wiggle. They don't wiggle. They're steady. And look at this, you can jump in the tree and you can do a handstand. She's like, oh yeah, that's great. And so nobody to share that with that excitement with, but I played all night. Wow. I felt like I played through the entire game without stopping ever.
Nice. Is that why you guys launched a website? You're like, my wife won't listen, now the internet has.
Now we're going to make you all listen.
Pear likes to define the Nintendo 64 era as Nintendo trying to defy expectations, something he always brings up when we talk about it. And they tried to do it through a number of ways. Number one was to stick with cartridges, right? Like, that was a bummer for a lot of people because the industry was going towards CDs. You guys are probably tired of hearing that, but it's true.
Hey, Jose, I have a primary source about that.
Oh, wow.
IGN64.com magazine.
Wow.
What? Yeah.
Signed by Pear and Matt Casamassina.
Oh, wow. That's
cool.
In
this, it has the top 10 reasons why Nintendo stuck with cartridges.
Oh, I love how you got an autograph from your boss.
Did you get that years ago?
He made me.
Oh, okay. You need the sign. Come on.
All right. Top 10 Nintendo marketing reasons why cartridges are better than CDs. Do you think you wrote this? I'll only read the top five. Some of them are a little offensive. Razor sharp edges of CDs could accidentally decapitate unsuspecting gamers.
There you go. Yep.
So, okay, wait. This list falls apart.
The edges of Wii U discs almost explain that because they're so soft. Continue.
Yeah. Reflecting sunlight off CDs can result in permanent blindness.
Yeah.
You guys are getting real funny here. Here's a strange one. Charles Manson, well-known CD advocate.
Yep. So we had...
Oh, my God!
I feel like I must explain.
No, let me get through.
We wrote this magazine in a weekend. We had a website to run on the weekdays.
I'm going to make you squirm. Okay. CDs made with skin of endangered animals.
Yeah.
What? There's no skin... Okay, you know
and
what?
And finally, number one, cartridges aren't just media storage. They're portable friends.
Aww, that's kind of nice.
It was a lonely weekend.
All right.
But back then, no one could carry a CD anywhere.
But like, I mean, think about it, right? Like, when CDs came out, when you got to play PlayStation, you got to play Saturn, there were some other platforms before that. Remember the 3DO, right? The gaming revolution? Yeah. We were like, all right, that's it. CDs, it makes sense. You have all this storage space. The music sounds beautiful because it's just streaming off the disc. Redbook audio. Redbook. And then Nintendo goes, yep, and then it's going to be cartridges. And, you know, developers freaked out because they have, you know, when you order 100,000 games you want to sell in stores, you have to pay Nintendo for those 100,000 cartridges
that's how it worked.
The bat, right? Yeah. Whereas you had to pay pennies for making CDs to the CD consortium at the time. So this was a big shock to the industry, but I think it was also a big shock to consumers who thought CD was the next thing.
Yep. And then everything would be $39.99.
Yeah, so look forward to NX.
So then there were other things, right? The controller, which had the first analog stick, I think, on a console device, which was cool.
Yeah.
But it was also the weirdest thing you could possibly hold in your hands because you didn't know exactly how to grip it. Was it from the sides, the middle, or the middle and the right? Like, it was just the weirdest thing.
Do you remember your friend teaching you that? Like, I just remember going over to somebody's house and be like, no, you hold it like this.
Lots of people held it on the outside, right? And tried to get to the stick in the middle.
Yeah, and the C stick, the C buttons were
so small.
Nintendo
themselves had trained us for decades at that point to just hold a controller like that. Yeah. And all of a sudden, your hands were together like this, like you were holding shears in your garden.
It was a cool idea, but they never actually, you know, you were able to hold it on the left, too, where you had a D-pad and the stick at the same time. I think there were like two games that used that, and they were really bad. So it was kind of like the concept was great, but you didn't really need that.
But it feels like it was entirely designed around Super Mario 64, which you almost got immediately the first time you picked up that controller. And I think it's like, people are talking about VR now in the way that we talked about Mario 64 the first time. Because, you know, we've been so used to 3D games for so long, and we're so comfortable with them, there hasn't really been that leap. Motion controls were kind of there, right?
Yep.
But the first time you played Mario 64, and you moved that joystick around, and he started running in circles, slow or fast, and you flicked back, and he did backflips and stuff, you were like, there's something special here.
Well, and that was the cool thing. I don't remember any game having that fidelity of control, right? Just like, you inch a little forward, he's tiptoeing, you push the analog all the way, he's off, and he's running, and you weren't holding a run button, and it was just something that was almost liberating, but then the game design itself was like exploring a space in a way you hadn't done. Right, we had Tomb Raider, which was the other 3D platformer, but it was like doing a math problem in order to like cross a chasm.
you had to plan your jump ahead and then tell Lara, "Hey, I'm gonna jump in a second."
I loved that game, but when people would watch me play that game, they'd be like, "Why do you put up with this?"
You know,
and I was incredulous. I was like, "It's fine. What are you talking about?"
You know what else was new was pixie dust around the stick.
Oh yeah.
Do you guys remember the pixie dust?
The stick over
like,
the
if you look closely, there'd be like little shavings from the controller because it was like octagonal or something, the casing.
The shavings could be from you, too. Remember when you played...
Oh, that's no.
Oh.
When you played Mario Party?
Can you bring up the controller?
Yeah, so I'm going to switch over.
Crazy.
It's actual size.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we're going to go quickly through. There were obviously peripherals like the Rumble Pack, the Transfer Pack, the Nintendo 64 DD, which we never got. The expansion pack, which is
this
not pictured.
This has 64 DD, the truth in it. I can read it
four
to you.
4 megabytes of RAM.
I don't think
RAM.
We should ever read from that magazine.
The truth.
It's full of lies.
It's an exposed.
But that was, I almost feel like the 64 DD was an apology to Square Enix, so to Square at the time, right? Like Square said, we can't make Final Fantasy. Fantasy on a cartridge, and then Nintendo said, ah, we have another plan. Here's a disk drive that lets you write a lot of data, and it's cheaper, and you know, it never came out in the U.S. We have one in the office, and it's pretty bad.
But then, to try and stave off hungry gamers who were just, they wanted games, and the waiting for games was very, very hard on them, there was the Dream Team, which, Per will tell you, was probably one of the worst PR moves Nintendo ever performed in possibly the history of the company, for a lot of reasons. What was the Dream Team?
Well, they, you know, Nintendo announced very proudly that the N64 was about quality, not quantity, right? And at the time, it came on the heels of developers and publishers like Konami, Capcom, Square, Enix, all these companies saying cartridge model is too risky. You know, it's like going back back to the past. We love CD. And so Nintendo countered by saying, well, we have this invite-only list of people who are allowed to make games for the machine. And here they are, the 10, right? Like, if you look at them, I don't know if you can remember some of them, but, like, Williams Midway was really controversial.
Amazing
because
pinball machines.
They made great pinball machines, but they made pretty bad arcade games, right? Namco and Sega ruled the arcades. You know, Williams was not up there, and Cruisin' 64 was obviously one of the products from this Dream Team. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the other companies, some of them never produced titles for the N64. Like, for example, you had Sierra Online, right? People made King's Quest, once a great company, didn't make a single game. You had Virgin, never made a game. But of course, the big one was Robotech, Crystal Dreams from Game Tech, which everybody, you know, I still meet people who say, I bought an N64 for that game. And it never came out, and we had an early version of the game, and it was just, you could tell, they were really struggling with the hardware and just couldn't make it happen.
Is that what the cover story, A Farewell to Robotech, is about in this?
Is it misspelled?
No.
It was a weekend. And then DMA Design, of course, delivered. If you ever played Body Harvest or Space Station Silicon Valley.
That was a great
this
game.
This team was once called DMA Design. They made Lemmings, and what do they make now?
Grand Theft Auto,
right? Yeah. Like, so that was a good get. They just made the wrong games.
So, there was a happy version to this tale, though. Specifically, three games that changed the industry in a way that no one expected them to. And the first one of the big three was GoldenEye 007. The movie tie-in came out a year or so after the film, but the game that ushered in FPS multiplayer on console, which was the dream. Every other game was trying.
Huh? He's got a weird mouth, right? Once you look at the mouth, you cannot unsee it now.
It's true, yeah. It looks like his mouth is stretched past his gun.
Yeah.
See, there it is. Now you see it.
Have you guys heard the conspiracy theory that that's just Donkey Kong?
Oh,
I like that. That's
we ruined
a good theory. You guys have fond memories of GoldenEye, right?
Oh,
I mean, everybody played it. You guys have fond memories of GoldenEye? Yes, yes, yeah?
Late
right,
night.
Cool.
But, like, FPSs on consoles were not a thing. You had, like, what is it, like, Kiliak the Blood and all that stuff, like early PlayStation attempts that just didn't connect, and it took the four-player split screen and then, of course, all the creative ways of how you made your friend not look at your screen with little cardboard setups.
Oh, we actually did
promises.
That. We did that in my dorm room.
Did the cardboard thing?
Yeah, no, I almost failed out of college because of this guy.
According to this pair, you need a video wall processor to split your screen into
four
distinct windows. And so there's a question that they wrote that they answered.
We're going to put that on the side.
Did you guys ever really get a device to split your...
No, I think we made that up.
No, was that a real product they sold?
Can you imagine?
There.
No, we got cardboard and taped it to the TV, and two people sat on chairs on the top of like a dorm room bed, and they looked at the top of the cardboard with the thing down the middle, and two people sat underneath with a blanket, and if anybody ever came by, it was like, oh, that's why you're all single.
Oh,
it was like you
wow.
made your own virtual boys.
Yeah, we made our own virtual boys, because people were screaming. Like,
can I ask a question? How big was the TV?
Oh, incredibly small. It was like
we have an editorial.
Yeah,
it was very deep.
Yeah, it was like 18 inches in the screen, and then like 4 feet in the butt.
Yep. I don't even know how that's safe. Okay, so then the next game of the big three, the one that changed my life, I feel forever, was Zelda: Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
This was the dream, right? Like Zelda for so many people was this amazing experience from its original inception to the last great version of it, which was a Link to the Past. Mm-hmm. And even on Game Boy, it was amazing. Link's Awakening was really cool. It took a lot of risks, tried different things. But then Ocarina of Time absolutely blew the doors open with this game that was part adventure, part dungeon quest solving, part everything, and everything translated so beautifully to 3D.
And the hype level was unreal for that game before it came out, you know, because everybody had seen this other game that we'll talk about in a second and said, man, what if they make an action adventure with this kind of camera system and where you kind of freely explore? And there really wasn't anything like that. You know, if you think back to those days, a lot of games were top-down. Nobody had solved the camera problem. This game solved the locking on, right? Like, how do you select which enemy you face and fight?
And make it easy.
It felt so natural. Yeah. And then, you know, it before it came out, everybody was losing their minds. Everybody just wanted to get their hands
on
it.
And this was the only Nintendo 64 game that IGN gave a 10 to.
That's right, yeah.
Well, that and he wrote that review, actually. Per Schneider penned that review. So then the last of the big three before we get on to... the list, as we're going to call it.
Chameleon Twist.
Super Mario 64. Which was one of the, if not the greatest launch game of all time.
Yep.
Right? I mean, is there anything better?
Well, Super Mario Brothers is a pretty good launch game, too.
It was. Pretty good. It was.
I mean, that's a good
pretty
one, too.
Good. Yeah, pretty good.
Super Mario 64 is still, to this day, one of the best, probably one of the top three 3D platformers of all time. I will go out and say that.
And we kind of take for granted what it did with the camera system. It just feels like, it seems so natural that you'd be able to hit a button and it would swing the camera left and right, and nobody had done that, right?
Yeah. Also, like, they answered the question before anybody even asked the question of, who's filming this?
Yeah.
And it was like, oh, Lakitu. There's a dude in a cloud flying around filming your entire video game.
Yeah, and there were like games, there was like Jumping Flash, right? That had come out before, a really cool kind of first-person platform game, but very kind of slow and deliberate, and you could easily miss jumps, and in Mario, they just kind of thought of all that, like they showed you a shadow where you would land, and they kind of set up these challenges for you to really learn the environment. And it's pretty amazing. If you go back now, you can see the genius and all the things that they invented that we now take for granted in games like The Witcher or, you know, Skyrim. Yeah. And it's pretty amazing.
Still the greatest hub world ever.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
It was all about secrets. It's like, okay, here's a new type of game. It's 3D. How do we hide stuff in it? And
right.
It was through really cool stuff, like a wall you could just walk into.
Yeah.
I love that kind of, or that when you could look up at the sun and then you'd warp to that.
Or like finding out, spoilers, that Yoshi's on the roof the entire time.
Yeah.
Like, what?
Yeah. And so swimming.
Cool. Yeah.
You know, like having a button go brr, 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 yep. Like to always swim forward. So many games mirror that now, even though there's no reason for you to pump a button, right?
Yep. So in the year 2000, IGN published a top 25 of the top 25 Nintendo 64 games. Excuse me. We're only going to focus on the first 10 because we assume you folks want to go home at some point tonight. And here they are. So this is the list. Zelda Ocarina of Time at number 1, Super Mario 64 at number 2, Perfect Dark at 3.
Look at that logo.
GoldenEye 007 at 4, Excitebike 64 at 5.
You guys loved Excitebike.
6
was very excited for it.
Wave Race 64. 7 was Banjo-Kazooie. 8, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. 9, Rayman 2, and 10, International Soccer. Which
Superstar Soccer 98.
Oh, okay. Everyone's
98 was
favorite
really
game.
Good.
Yeah, everyone played that, clearly.
That's a classic. Don't knock it. That was a great football game before there were great football games.
I think you
can knock it.
But oddly enough, even though this list was published in 2000, certain games hadn't come out yet. Conker's Bad Fur Day was not out yet.
Majora's Mask
was not out yet. Blast Corps is missing from this list, or maybe later on, I'm not sure, F-Zero X. What are some other games you guys remember, like, right?
Smash Brothers was a great answer, right? Mario Party 3.
Yeah,
I was going to say Mario Kart. Like, it's noticeably absent from this list. Yeah, I know it's, like, sort of divisive with people, and IGN, I don't think, gave it the greatest score.
No, we had some haters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had
some haters on the team that didn't feel like it lived up to the Super Nintendo version.
Right.
Yep. Yep. Well, and Rogue Squadron, one of the best Star Wars games ever, right?
Paper Mario. Yeah. Remember that?
Yep.
So this, I mean, this list is obviously very, very dusty.
And we
feel like we need to redo it.
Yeah, so we need your help. So this is what's going to go down. We're going to switch over to a board here. We've done this before. We call this little game Pole Position. It's a way to do sort of a live top 10 list with the audience help. So you have rules to follow, though, and I got to read them out loud just so you know what's going on. So first of all, we're going to raffle for your slot to come up here. That's not written up there. I'm just telling you that's how you get up here. And when you do, you also get to pick one of the plushies that are seated. So if it's Mario on the pipe up there, he's off duty. But anyone that has a pin on them, you can grab one. After you grab one, you have one of two moves you can perform on this list. The first one, you can swap positions of any two games on the list. The second, if you choose not to do the first one, is you can insert a game that isn't on the list at any number position and bump the game at the bottom of the list off. Mm-hmm. Quick catch. If a game has been bumped from the list, it can only be brought back once. And finally, a player move can be vetoed. So we understand some people make controversial decisions in life. That's 100% understandable. We all live on the internet. But if the four of us agree and feel that your move is a troll move or is a little bit too extreme, we can veto it, as long as all four of us agree.
In other words,
I'll back up the trolls if they're funny.
Yeah, well, I second that.
If it's Super Mario, let's say Superman 64,
yeah,
no,
going to number one on the list, we may veto it, except for Sam.
So please don't troll us.
I like that green fog.
So, but you will still get a prize. You'll just have trolled
us. You're just not getting a statue, sadly, but you do get to participate. You're going to get a mic, which hopefully we have ready. Just going to say that out loud real quick. And the first person we're going to ask is basically a raffle winner. So, Brian, why don't you reach into your magic bucket over there and let us know. Who is it?
450356.
Okay, so 450356. 450356.
You got somebody?
Raise your hand real quick. Great. Okay, so stay there because I do want to let, since Willie won the statue raffle, I'm going to let him start. You are our next participant, okay? Because I did want to let him do that. So why don't you come up here? Where's our mic?
Where's our mic?
You guys know where
right
our mic's
here,
at?
Guys.
Yeah.
Oh,
right here.
That's a mic?
Cool. Great. All right. So
it's a mic.
It's a mic. Speaking of that, test.
You all right,
very good.
Yeah. All right, you guys can hear Willie?
You're a natural.
We good?
All right.
We're good. Yep, we're good.
You see the list. You get to either recommend or swap places. What do you want to do?
Wow, this is hard. Okay. So number 10, I think, has to go.
Is that?
And I would like to add Rogue Squadron to that list.
That's a good
Rogue
call.
Squadron to the list. Okay.
I'm a huge Star Wars guy. I'm not vetoing that. That's a great game.
Where do you want it?
I'll probably put it at number 10 as well.
Okay.
Number 10.
Yeah. Okay, number 10.
Can we include it without the escort missions?
With the escort missions? Yeah. But, you know, no game was perfect. Right?
Yep. So defend your reason. Why does it deserve to be on this list?
I mean, Star Fox was great.
Yeah.
I mean, this is, one of the first great Star Wars games out there, especially when it comes to dogfighting.
Totally.
We really haven't had a game like that since, which makes me very sad. But, you know, I just feel like the options, the replayability, being able to just, you know, just take on missions with, you know, just living your dreams as, you know, playing as these different ships and kind of just experiencing the Star Wars world in such a way that I don't think we ever have before.
So Shadows of the Empire got it wrong. I mean, they got the first level right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
And that was it. Whereas this game did it right from start to finish, I felt.
So the thing about Shadows of the Empire, which I think someone will probably bring up at some point tonight, so let's get out of the room right now. I love that game for a lot of reasons, but I also hate it for a lot of reasons because I think it's kind of two games in one. It's got some really good flight combat stuff, and then the platforming and shooting stuff is a little more rickety. But I'm a big Star Wars Battlefront guy, and I think there's a lot of things that the game you suggested just now still did right more than a game that came out last year. What?
Sam, you're my boss, so you can still talk a little bit and pair. But I'm here to talk about the only game that truly deserves to be on this list, which is quite obviously Banjo-Kazooie.
Oh, come on!
It is the greatest Mario game ever made. And if any of you are making noises right now, you're actually incorrect. It's in chat.
You're an idiot!
So, honestly, when the Summer Banjo came out, it to me presented one of the best worlds, set characters, and whimsical tones that I had ever played in a game up until that point. That, to me, is peak Rare. That is Rare. That is a developer that, you know, made its name throughout the 80s and early 90s on the SNES, but I really feel like they hit their stride on the N64, especially with Banjo-Kazooie. The world design, the level design in that game is unparalleled in a 3D character platformer. You know, everything from Mumbo's Mountain to Treasure Trove Cove to Click Clack Woods, it has such an amazing sense of adventure and color, such a great cast of characters, and it has some of the best voice acting and lines of all time, such as and other assorted grunts. It absolutely holds up too. It held up when it was released on XBLA on 360, and just playing through it last year, the Rare replay, it's honestly, it is the game that defines 3D character platformers for me, and is the game that's the reason I'm so excited that we have this renaissance with stuff like Ukulele, and Hat in Time and Psychonauts 2, and I'm thinking of those games.
Cut his mic.
Without Banjo-Kazooie, everything from Grant Kirkhope's score that adapts as you get closer and closer to
that was cool.
levels, to the just variety of moves that you slowly learn throughout the game and master and use for bigger and better puzzles. And I will say, the game is perfect, 99% through. The little quiz show Death Play Pen can go straight to hell. It is an absolutely miraculous game. We played through it again on Christmas Day this year, and it absolutely holds up. It should be on this list, it needs to be on this list, and you find sirs and madams should have it number one. No, one, not 11. Number one.
Wow.
I'm Marty Sliva. Banjo-Kazooie is perfect. Go!
So we need to put it at one?
Yeah. Wow. So we're going to swap Banjo-Kazooie. That's Marty's move. He could not be here today. So we're going to do that really quick. Did the gentleman who just won the raffle a second ago, can you come on up here? Or Kirsten's going to find you. She has the mic.
Banjo at number one. That's kind of crazy.
Here. Just come on
up. Banjo at number one
is crazy.
Number
eight.
I love...
Oh, he's
going to
change that. We're
he's
going to
swap.
Yeah, it'll swap.
Cool. Yeah. I think that's crazy. That's saying it's better than Ocarina of Time.
Yeah, or Mario 64, which is a superior 3D platform.
Okay, but let's not all be haters. I mean, that game was really smart.
No,
come right?
on. No, let's be haters.
Huh?
Yeah, let's be a hater on that.
No,
Sam.
It's a good. It's a
I
very
could, I could
game.
Live with this list if Ocarina was swapped with it.
Okay, really? Well,
yeah.
Okay.
The number two best N64 game, Banjo-Kazooie.
Maybe.
All right, it's going to be a long night.
All right, so we've got our prize winner from earlier who won the raffle. Hi, say your name, please, and let us know what you want to do, swap or bump.
My name is Abel, and I want to bump off Excitebike and put Glover on there.
Okay.
Wow.
So
did you say Glover?
Glover.
Excitebike, above Excitebike, he's going to put in Glover.
I got to look that one
is
up.
Is he swapping or just adding?
Adding.
Adding.
All right.
Based on the famous actor Danny Glover, he got his own 3D platformer back in the day.
Okay, so defend your choice, sir. Defend your choice. Why is this a thing?
I just think with the way Super Mario 64 set the rules with how to play 3D space, Glover sort of took that in a crazier direction, just like with the way the actual character was. And there were certain levels he had to navigate with the ball, and he attached himself to the ball and literally like became the analog stick with the way you controlled the glove. And I don't know, I just had a lot of really great memories with that game and never played Excitebike, so.
So actually, I totally respect the hell out of that because there's like, I feel like this is a safe list we have right now, right? And it's obviously a list that's been kicking around IGN for a long time. And you brought in a game that's kind of like a sleeper hit that not a lot of people know about. And I think these games for posterity's sakes, or these lists especially, shouldn't just be like, here's the 10 things that you have to absolutely play, easily accessible, you can find them anywhere. Like, you gotta dig a little bit, you wanna do some research. And I think what you suggested is a great recommendation because it's something that, most people wouldn't be looking for. Your Marios and your Zeldas, even your Banjo-Kazooies, your GoldenEyes, those are things that people have been kicking around for decades now. But Glover? Nobody talks about Glover. So I'm totally down with Glover. And Danny Glover, the actor.
And House Glover. Yeah, that game was actually really good. I mean, I remember it was it really played with the concept of the glove on like balancing on a ball, too. Like the way the physics felt was really cool.
All right. Sam, anything to add?
I'm trying to find the review. Okay, I found it. Do you know who reviewed it?
Pierre Schneider.
Yeah, it's by Matt? Blank, so I think it's
no,
a
no, it wasn't me.
No,
it must have been later.
We gave it an 8.3. Great.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. There you have it. Great on the IGN scale.
All right.
So our next participant is actually a member of this panel. It's going to be Sam, and then we're going to draw another raffle. So, Sam, you're our next contestant. So what are you going to do? Are you going to introduce a game, or are you going to swap a game?
My plan was to definitely add Majora's Mask.
Okay, you're going to add Majora's Mask.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
That's a good choice. How many of you like Majora's Mask? You guys with us, right? You like Majora's Mask. Cool. What, where?
Oh, boy. I guess with this list right now, I would put it above, or below, sorry, like in the sixth place above GoldenEye. Although I don't think I'd keep Perfect Dark up there, but I can only make one change.
Okay,
I really like Perfect Dark, though.
So one more time, you're going to...
I would say it should be in, like, the five-ish position. Although, I feel bad about putting GoldenEye down one. But just leave it there for now. Somebody
that's good.
All right.
Good.
Zelda Majora's Mask is now five on the list.
So Rayman 2, The Great Escape, just got kicked off the list.
Yep.
Oh.
Is that what we're looking at?
Yep.
Okay.
You didn't play that game.
No, I mean,
wait, you didn't.
Of course I played that game. I'm trying to see if like I'm okay with the way all this sits right now. So interesting thing about Majora's Mask. I didn't really fall in love with that game at first.
I think a lot of people didn't.
I didn't fall in love with that game until the 3DS.
It was dark. It was dark and made you feel bad.
No, I love all that kind of stuff. I just feel like the time system was really stupid.
I forgot
it
about
was stressful.
The jersey thing.
Yeah, like, it was very stressful.
And it's also like I like to take my time in an open world game or in a dungeon and to constantly have that impending doom feeling, which I know is a great gameplay element that worked right into the narrative. Kind of stressed me the hell out, and I would have rather just had something I could play at my own pace.
Well, and it didn't help that the way the game was designed, it didn't go out of its way to show you there's a song to slow things down.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think that was the thing that kind of caught people off guard. It was like if you didn't really catch that, or if your friends didn't tell you about it, you just felt like I'm running out of time. What am I going to do? I'm running out of time. But that game's brilliant just because it is the perfect version of, I think, a Zelda town, or the way a town has been implemented in a Zelda game.
It felt so alive, right? A smart town in any game.
Yeah. I mean, there's obviously we've seen other games since then that have, you know, these routines and characters walk around in, but in this one, it was very much an early, you know, 2001 title where you were kind of keeping track on what people were doing, finding certain times to meet them, completing tasks. So they give you a mask, with some of the masks had different abilities and they were cool. And I think all of that, and also, I mean, it was creepy though, right? Like seeing Link transform into these different forms. We hadn't seen that in a Zelda before.
Yeah, that was the one part where I felt like, okay, Banjo-Kazooie had done it better, and I felt like it was almost like Nintendo doing what Rare did, who did what Nintendo did, right?
Right.
But then Majora's Mask had this weird sense of voyeurism where you're like, you're following people around and you're learning more and more about what they do, and then it turns out like what they're doing in the game is really interesting or really tragic or really weird, and like, I remember when you finally, like, it was so hard to get to the damn farm, right? Like, when you finally figured out how to get to the farm before something happens there.
Yep.
And then you're lurking and it turns dark and you're like, oh my God.
It's aliens.
It's crazy, like, right? Like,
it was such
a cool moment.
It was like when people ask you, like, what would you do if there was only, like, one day left in the universe?
Yeah.
Like, you actually find out what a lot of people will do in a situation like that.
Yeah.
And then
shoot arrows.
Yeah, and in that game, it's like a lot of very weird answers. So,
I think it's the second hardest Zelda game too, after Zelda 2. Zelda 2 is the hardest Zelda game.
Yeah, one of the most difficult. Absolutely.
Zelda 1's pretty hard, but I think this game, I died a lot. I couldn't figure out stuff, and it was just it spent so much time on it because of that. I feel like I owe it a high place on this list.
So if you're sitting in the audience. Oh, sorry. I just meant to say, if you're sitting in the audience and you have not played this game, the 3DS remake is really smart.
It
fixes
so
a lot of issues. The Bomber's Notebook is very useful. Like, I can't help but recommend it to any and everyone.
Yeah, just clamshelling that game in the middle of whatever you're doing is so
nice. I think that's why I fell in love with it, because I was like, oh, I can just walk away right now.
and that game went through a lot of changes, believe it or not. But next contestant is a raffle winner, so let's go to the bucket. See
right. Do we give away prizes for these two yet?
Actually, we have to make sure he gets his plushie, so we'll do it afterwards.
Okay. Yeah, are we picking them for them?
No, we'll just have them come up after.
Oh, it's going to be a free-for-all.
Well, fighting for Lemmy. Maybe.
For them?
I don't want everyone to just come up and grab something.
We'll make that happen.
All right. All right. Get the thing.
Next up, we have 450-397. 450-397.
Check your ticket. 450-397. You're here. You must be here. We have a ticket for you.
It's going away.
Hey,
you. There we go.
Up. There you go.
All right. Where's the mic? Anybody? Somebody.
Second row.
Oh, cool. Oh, hang on to that because we're gonna match tickets with you later. We're gonna get you a mic in a
Kirsten,
second.
Where's
also,
our
we're
mic?
Totally on an honor system here. I just assume that's what your ticket says.
Hey, hi. Oh, Kirsten's got the mic. She's just gonna bring it up right here. And you guys are all good.
I hope you have a good answer ready.
Yep. Thank you, Kirsten. All right, cool. What's your name?
My name is Brian.
All right,
hi, Brian.
Ooh. Nice and loud into the mic, just because this is going to go live on the site and all over the place. So tell us, what do you want to do? Do you want to swap a game, or do you want to add a game to this list?
I'm going to have to do something.
A little closer to the mic, sorry.
Yeah, I'm going to do something a little bit simpler. I just want to swap a game.
Okay, gonna swap a game. All right.
All right.
I'm going to bring Ocarina of Time back to number one.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. All right, someone did it. Thank you.
So here's the thing. Bold choice. Also, I don't think a lot of people are going to dispute that one. Because that's I really think when you look at the N64, and I was talking about this with Jose before when we were talking about the show, it really comes down to two games that could ostensibly be the number one choice. And to me, it's either Super Mario 64 or Ocarina of Time.
Yep.
And I don't think anyone would walk out of this room really upset about either of those choices taking the number one spot. So good move, bold move, safe move, but I'm glad you made it.
Cool. All right. Thanks a lot. Sweet. All right. Next contestant is going to be a staff member. It's going to be Pear.
Oh.
So Pear, we love Pear Steiner, right? We do.
Thank you. Thank you.
GM money. Bask in the GM-ness.
Das hype.
So what are you going to do?
So I like the list. I got to be honest. I don't love Glover up there. I think it's a good game, but I don't think it's a top 10 game when I think about everything that's not on there, including some favorite games that not everybody loves of mine, like Blast Corps. Not going to put that on, though. And I think Tony Hawk was a really good game, but it doesn't define the N64 for me, so I think it's going to be on its way out. And so right after GoldenEye, I would like to insert Mario Kart 64.
Oh,
because I have so many fond memories
of
playing that game with my friends. Now, we played it mostly three-player. Four-player was kind of messy, right? It was a little choppy, but I feel like back then we got used to even the worst frame rates,
yep.
And we found the fun in the game. And this game, in the two-player championship mode is excellent. The three-player is great. And like that battle mode. I want it back. Where is it?
Right? That battle mode has never truly been replicated that well.
Yeah.
Especially not
in
the newest
Mario Kart.
Don't
you guys think it was like a thing of the times, though? Like maybe battle mode wouldn't be fun if it...
No.
You don't
it's
know.
Still great.
Really? I mean, they didn't even bother trying in Mario Kart 8, so who knows, right?
I don't know.
It was another one. It was in Double Dash, right?
Yeah, but Double Dash was different.
Double Dash was really good.
I didn't like the map design in Double Dash. No, I like Double Dash a lot, but
you better.
I don't think the battle mode map design was good in Double Dash.
That's what the problem is that when they bring it back, the maps aren't good enough?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean...
I think you're over it. You just don't know it.
No way. Block Fort is awesome. The city skyscraper thing is awesome. The giant donut full of lava is awesome.
I didn't like that one.
What?
I didn't like the donut.
Oh, it was great.
But I liked all the more complex things because you could... You know, for the first time, you could escape by going high, right? Like in the Super NES version, you had to figure out how to get behind corners so you wouldn't get hit. In this one, you could go from above and you could lurk for someone. It was just, there was so much to do in that game. Loved it.
All right. Okay.
And the music was amazing, too.
All right. Next contestant is a raffle winner. So brace yourselves. Get your tickets out.
Here we go.
I hope it's my Mario Party plant.
450-390. 450-390.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Second row.
Yeah, right next to the last winner.
This is a very lucky row.
Nice.
I'll be seeing
you in
a few
minutes.
Here's the mic right here. Just make sure it's on. If you check, all right.
One more.
You'll see the controls on.
Flip up the button.
Yeah.
There you go.
Sweet. Now test it, just to be sure.
Perfect.
Keep going. Keep trying.
Test.
Oh,
there we are. What's up, man?
Nice and loud into the mic. What's your name?
Max.
Nice to meet you, Max.
What's up, Max?
Hey, Max.
So, you've been here joining us for this. What do you want to do?
I will put in Super Smash Bros. At number 8.
Oh,
okay.
See, Sid Bros.
So
how is that not on our list?
Wave Race. Because it hadn't come out yet.
Yeah.
Wait, Smash Brothers was not on the.
No.
This is good. This is getting interesting. Okay.
Okay, so tell us about Race. Why Smash Brothers?
Well, man, I think Smash Bros. Can just appeal to a lot of people because there's a hardcore following for Smash Brothers, and there's more casual following, and you have all the different customization with items and all the different ways that you can tweak and play the game, and there's the whole arcade mode.
Yep.
And I just think it's a really defining game. When I think N64, I think of all the time that I've spent with my friends just playing Super Smash Bros.
Yep.
And all the experiences with that.
Another great four-player multiplayer game, right? It, like, it was something that, like, it just felt like Black Magic at the time.
And one that did not come to the U.S. easily, because I remember we were playing the import, and we were very excited about it, and we kept on talking to Nintendo of America reps about it, and they were really nervous about releasing a game where these mascots are beating each other up. And like, if you played the Japanese version, the sound effects are very different. They sound like Street Fighter. It sounds like punching and hitting. And the U.S. version has bowling noises. Like, very different style.
That would happen.
Yeah, they changed a lot. They also took out the hum from the lightsaber because, you know, Lucas was watching.
Right.
Like, the Japanese, changed all the blood to sweat.
There was no blood in it. No, but the Japanese version sounded, it was a little more visceral than the American one, if that's the right word for like Pikachu hitting Link. But they were very worried about bringing that game to the U.S., and then, of course, it was this tremendous success.
Well, it's interesting like to see, I don't know, by that point, Nintendo had enough IP that people recognized, but the idea of putting them all in one game, right? Like, you know, Samus next to Mario, next to Link, next to, like, it was just, it was this all-star roster that... you know, I wasn't the biggest fan of the frame rate, but how simplified the controls were, you couldn't help but pick it up and feel somewhat competent.
It was a very Sega thing to do, right? Sega had played around with mixing their franchises with really strange things. When they had Fighters Mega Mix and all that kind of stuff where you fight a car, like the Daytona car is one of the fighters with like the, fighting you with the tires and stuff. But like it didn't feel like a Nintendo thing to do. And now, of course, you just look back and you're like, it's such a no-brainer to do.
It's the only appearance of Samus on the Nintendo 64.
Yeah, that's so true.
That's true. Talk about that. Wait. Talk about that. What happened there? What do you remember from that, if you remember anything at all?
From that era, well, the tragic accident happened, right? Like Gunpei Yokoi was killed in a car accident. And I feel like because he was so synonymous with that franchise internally at Nintendo as the champion, you know, it wasn't a Miyamoto game. I think people just didn't want to touch it. And then I think there was the worry about, you know, don't underestimate how hard it was to do Mario and Zelda in the third dimension. And now you have a shooting element in it, right? I think they were very worried about pulling off Metroid in 3D with a third-person perspective. And I think they just, it was too daunting.
Yeah,
and then it never sold that well here, right? Like Super Metroid was not the hit here that it was in Japan.
Even though GoldenEye was a big hit, Nintendo was very nervous about a game where you're shooting people. Yep. I mean, just recently there was an interview with someone who worked on that game, or during a presentation, he talked about how Nintendo asked him to just put in this sort of happy ending to how GoldenEye works. I would only imagine, too, that maybe they were worried about just first-person violence in general. Nintendo tended to worry about things like that. They still do with some of the things that they do.
Yeah, and I think they were happy that some of the third parties came in, right? Doom 64, another game that was actually really good. You know, there was Turok, of course, from Iguana. There was Quake, a version of Quake running on the N64. And I think they were happy that the third parties were filling that void so they didn't have to.
An amazing Resident Evil occurred on Nintendo 64 at the time.
That was actually one of the Dream Team developers ported that, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
No, totally.
But yeah, Smash Brothers is special. I'm so glad it's on this list. It brought not only the characters together, but also their worlds, their weapons, their scenarios, their music. Like
ultimate soundtrack.
The fact that you could go from like Hyrule Castle to the ship from Star Fox and fight each other on it was something very special and very unique. And yeah, I think that mascot fighting game has been... they've tried to replicate it so many times. So many other companies have tried it. PlayStation All-Stars, you look at...
Ubisoft. Ninja Turtles.
It just doesn't come together the way Nintendo makes it come together. And even up to the newest Smash Brothers that we've got recently, which brought together even more third parties than ever, just this big celebration, this huge toy box of franchises. There's really nothing like it in games, and I think it absolutely deserves a place in this list.
Yeah, and they've only gotten better at making it. Like it's incredible what Sakurai has done with that game.
I'm bummed about the Wave Race drop, though. Wave Race 64
we'll
is so good.
You can ride
so
a dolphin
good.
In that game.
Huh? You can ride a dolphin. That was not what was so good about it. No, it had a level where the water level changed and you had to adapt to the course change.
Yeah,
like,
okay.
Nobody had done that.
Okay. That's true. Was that like per lap, the water level raise?
Yeah, that was
really awesome to watch.
Good
love
stuff.
That game.
Good stuff. All right, next contestant is Brian Altano.
Oh, hi, what's up? So we talked earlier about how I personally feel how the N64 list, no matter who writes it or how you do it, has two games that are, number one, interchangeable at the top. Ocarina of Time or Super Mario 64. Guess what I'm doing. Super Mario 64 is now the number one game of all time, according to this list that we wrote today. So move Mario 64 up to the top. Can I get some applause for that one?
Yeah. All right.
There we go.
I can live with that.
You can't be mad at it. It's not like I put, like, Tony Hawk up there. That would have been a problem. Mario 64, up at the top. Do I need to explain why? I feel like
A little. I mean, I think you should. We've said enough, but at the same time, I want to hear more.
So I feel like it's very rare that, first of all, in terms of launch games, this is one of the greatest, if not the greatest, launch game of all time. I think definitely from Nintendo, as we said earlier. It's also very rare that a company just gets it so right out the gate. It's just so perfect. It's such a perfect game that it scales well to whoever's playing it. If someone's playing it for the first time and they just want a sandbox game, it works. If somebody's playing it and they have a sort of modest level, novice level of expertise, they can go in, get enough stars to finish the game. If you're crazy and you're an expert and you're a completionist, you're playing Super Mario 64 for dozens of hours. It scales to who you are, it scales to the technology, and it works perfectly with that controller, which is the entire crux of this console. So Super Mario 64 is the number one N64 game of all time, according to me, and hopefully this list, depending on what happens in the next few minutes.
All right.
Thank
good
you.
Choice. Good all choice. Right. Thanks a lot. Our next participant is a raffle winner. So let's reach into the raffle, get your tickets out.
Don't
folks.
Screw this up for me, raffle winner. 450-395. 450-395.
Whoa, we got him. Come on up.
What do we got?
Second row.
Wow, a lot of second row winners. You guys all work together with our people? What happened? All right. So nice and loud into the mic. What is your name?
My name's Justin.
Hi,
nice
Justin.
To meet you, Justin.
Hi, Justin.
Thanks
for coming, man.
Nice to meet you guys, too. I'm going to have to move GoldenEye up to number 4.
Wow.
Ooh, okay. Call. So swapping GoldenEye to number 4. All right. So tell us why.
I'm totally cool with that.
Why is
way.
It better than Me the too. Two games that now got bumped under?
Well, approximately 18 years ago, I still have fond memories of finding my little brother cowering in a bathroom stall and shooting him in the head.
In the game, right?
In the game, of course. And I just can't imagine those other games being ahead of that.
No, so you're a facility player. Facility exactly. is the best map in that game.
Yeah. Exactly.
Did you play with proximity mines?
No.
What'd you play with? What was your loadout?
The AK-47.
Do you play as Odd Job?
No, always Bond.
Oh, good.
Always Bond. I like that. So definitive. Yeah, no, you picked a great game. I'm totally with you. It deserves to rise up the list. Number 4 is probably the perfect spot for that game. Like, a weird thing that we're not really bringing into account too much is how well a game holds up in 2016. I don't know how much that plays into it.
Well, Perfect Dark would not be where it is.
I'm with you. I actually think that GoldenEye has aged far better than Perfect Dark, as evidenced by the Xbox Live Arcade port of Perfect Dark.
But the first 3 games on this list aged really well.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm totally with that.
All right. I just want to see where we're at. Okay. So
Marty's really happy about this list, by the way. Banjo-Kazooie is the number 3 in 64.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's happy with
but
that.
But I'm even happier because Mario 64 is beating it.
Okay. So initially, I was going to be the last contestant for this, but I want to ask someone in the room. So wait, is Jared still here? Is Jared Petty still here, or did he vanish?
We got Brandon.
Okay. So then I'm going to give up my spot to Brendan
what
Graber.
What a chicken.
So Brendan Graber, come on up here. Brendan works on our Wikis team. Please, give him a better applause than that.
Brendan.
Come on, you got to.
What you do
three.
About Mario Party?
So I love Brendan, and Brendan does a lot of great work, so he's going to be the Jared understudy, because I initially was going to surprise Jared. Brendan, what do you think?
All right. At number 7.
Yes.
Mario Party 2.
All right. Mario Party 2.
The one with the cowboy on the cover?
Defend why, Brendan Graber?
In my experience, Mario Party 2 has to be the definitive party game that I've ever played. Still to this day, me and my wife and my wife's brother and sister, like, we'll keep playing that game on our Wii U port, and it's still the best, like, I will hate my friend's simulator to this day.
You guys still play it to this day?
Yes, to
That's
this day.
That's awesome.
We always usually play the monster, the mansion, Haunted Mansion level, and the Western level with Hootenannies.
Yep.
There's no greater way to ruin someone's day. Like, oh, you're by the star? Hootenanny time, get back over here. And like it built off everything that Mario Party 1 did without the killing your wrists.
Yep, you didn't have to mail it in and get a glove in return.
There's so much better controls, and they kept all the good minigames and brought in a bunch of new ones. Like, I played the ones that came after, and I can never find that great experience of minigames that Mario Party 2 had. I think they probably had the best lineup.
Or especially that balance of, like really cool board game design to minigames to fairness, I think, is a good word. Because I think, like, the Mario Party franchise has this way of being like, all right, so you landed, you beat the most minigames, you screwed everybody over.
Total reversal.
You're totally awesome. But somebody else walked by
five
clouds, and they're like, he wins. And you're like, what?
Yeah, it's like Tuesday bonus.
Yeah.
100 stars.
Yep. Also, it feels Mario like being in a casino.
Mario Party 1 was mean. When you lost, it was like, you lose, fail. One of my friends cried. Like, oh, no.
Last
it was so
year.
Mean to him.
That's yep, really good.
Pick.
All right.
All right, here's 20 bucks, Brendan. Thank you.
Yeah.
I just had to get rid of that meddling Jared.
All right. So we did it. We made a list together. What do you guys think of the list so far? I mean, did we get it right?
I like it, but I feel like you should go too, because I think that's a chicken move to not be one of the people on the at the podium to, well, if to I make gotta, a pick.
Well, if I have to go, I think we should have them one more raffle winner.
Okay, let's
all
do
right.
that.
All right, fine. Even. Fair all enough. Right,
so draw in the bucket one more time.
I mean, I like the list. I think it's pretty good, Wave Race 64.
I think it is, too.
It needs
Glover's
a little work.
Glover's making you a squirm. Form. I can see it.
Yeah.
Are you guys ready?
All right.
450-372.
This guy's going to ruin it all.
450-372.
450.
Back row.
Oh, hey, yeah. Oh. Hello. Welcome to the stage.
Welcome.
Yeah, that thing. Hi. Oh, hey, hold on up? To that. Don't lose your ticket because yeah. we're going to basically meet up with you after to give you one of those. So, what's your name?
Paul.
Nice to meet you, Paul. What's Thank up? You for coming.
You guys are going to hate me.
Uh-oh. No.
Uh-oh.
All of Don't us? Do it. Actually, that was it for
All
today.
All of us are
guys.
Specifically. And we're done.
Thanks Not for coming welcome. Today, everybody.
All right, Paul.
WWF No Mercy.
Wow. Oh, good choice. Good choice. But where? Where are you going to put it?
Number five.
Whoa.
Number five. Okay, let's see this. Number five.
Are we losing Glover?
Ooh. Glover's out. No.
Okay. Smash Brothers is hanging on.
By
what is it?
Thread.
You did such a slow, dramatic drag into the discarded folder.
That was it. All right, defend this. Why? I mean, I think I know why, but I want to hear why from you.
You have the co-op for four players. You also have the customization, weapons everywhere, the rumble, steel cage match, I mean, everything.
Who made this game? This wasn't the Acclaim one, right?
No. Great. That it was THQ. And the Acclaim games, in fact, looked like last year's news compared to the WWF games. Like No Mercy and WrestleMania 2000, was it? Was the other one?
That was one before.
Yeah, the one before it. They were both fantastic games. Really good, again, four-player games. And I felt like the PlayStation could not keep up, honestly, on that front.
So I think the this is kind of understated. I'm totally with you on this. A lot of people don't really talk about this, but the wrestling games on N64 did for wrestling games what Ocarina of Time did for the Zelda games.
Yes.
I feel like that jump from 2D to 3D was so huge, and there were so many potentials to get that wrong. If you look at old school wrestling games that we grew up with, like, they're not great.
Pro wrestling on the NES?
Yeah. Wrestling for NES. There was like the WWE games, like Royal Rumble and Raw, that came to Super Nintendo and Genesis and stuff.
WrestleMania?
Like, what was Starman in?
Oh, what was that called? Was
I remember
called
that.
Wrestling?
Oh, I don't remember.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, Starman, and there was that, what was it, like a monster?
Yeah.
And he bit people's
he was
head.
A sea monster.
Yeah.
Yeah, it made no sense. They had just regular dudes and then just a sea monster. I was like, all right, you're just going to let a sea monster in the ring? That's cool. There should be health violations against this. But no, I'm totally with you. That's a really good pick. And it's cool to see, I guess, can we call it a sports game? It's kind of a sports game on this list.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Sports entertainment. But we got
sports
it.
Entertainment.
All right. There you go. Thank you so much.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
Yeah.
No, yeah, good pick. I remember Nitro, all those games as well that we played back then.
Yeah, I thought that was a really good pick as well. All right. So I'm going to take a quick glance behind me, and it's really hard to do because the list is only behind us. I can't see it on my computer. I should have probably set something up so I could, but I'm just going to. Winston, it's okay. I promise. So I'm just going to turn. Hopefully I didn't break it. So our list right now, number one, Super Mario 64, number two, Zelda Ocarina of Time, number three, Banjo-Kazooie, number four, GoldenEye 007, number five is WWF No Mercy, number six is Perfect Dark, number seven is Zelda Majora's Mask, I love that game, number eight is Mario Party 2, followed by number nine, Mario Kart 64, followed by Smash Brothers at number 10.
All right, so I don't want to influence you.
Pretty good.
I don't know how far we're going to get into this.
Okay.
But let's have a quick... brief discussion on this list from the panel right here. I have a feeling, I'm going to tell you right now, Mario Kart 64 is too low on this list. It should be higher up on the list.
Okay.
I feel like Perfect Dark is too high on this list and should come lower. I feel like Mario Kart 64 and Perfect Dark should switch. Again, not to influence you. It's just what I'm saying.
Yeah, I don't want to influence you either. There are a couple of franchises that are very dear to me that I feel like I'm missing. There's F-Zero X, for example, if you guys remember that one, right? Like, brutal racer, 60 frames per second, dozens of cars on the screen, amazing game. Wave Race 64, also not on the list. There's still a bunch of really good ones that are not on there. But again, it's your choice.
Which one?
Rocket Robot on Wheels.
Yeah.
That was an amazing game. Like, one of the first games. Like, it really, like, the new Zelda actually reminds me of that because you just have fun with physics and, like, you know, That was a good game, too.
Sam, do you not want to influence me either, but have a recommendation?
You know I'm just going to start adding things like Banjo-Tooie and Conker. Don't let me even talk.
Conker is not
Conker's
on there either.
Conker's Bad Fur Day is not on this list. On
but
how
as,
is that
like,
okay?
As we're all learning tonight, it's not easy making a top 10.
No.
It's actually incredibly fun. These are the conversations we have in this building all the time. So when we read the comments on our top 10s, we're like, well, yeah, they're kind of right, and some of us agree with some of them. Exactly. Because there's really, it's very hard to just land on a perfect 10.
I feel like there's like some weird Otero game that you're thinking of, like Tetris Sphere or something like that.
No, that's not no,
I know.
I'm not.
I know what Jose's gonna do.
What am I gonna do?
You're gonna mess with my number one.
Oh, am I? What's your number one again? Oh, ooh. But that's so predictable, though, right? Like, would I put a game that changed my life as the number one game on IGN's top?
What are you doing?
25.
Where are we going?
Or
with
top
this?
10?
You're doing it, aren't you?
Can we swap Zelda: Ocarina of Time and Super Mario?
Oh, come on!
Please.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Please.
Oh.
And let me tell you why.
Why do you know?
Because, quite frankly, all right. No, seriously.
I'm with you. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Zelda 64 was the dream, man.
It's not the
like,
title.
It really
of the game.
Was. It wasn't, but it was the dream for so many people. You don't understand. This was the game that immediately reignited my love with Nintendo again, right? Because it was something that I felt like as I got older and I ended up playing PlayStation games and I ended up falling into more friends who were part of that ecosystem.
Yeah.
Zelda was the game that brought me back, and it was just like I had to be there for that. So there is no universe where Super Mario 64 would lead this list if I had a chance to do it. And that's no disrespect. And
no, man, I'm wearing a Zelda shirt right now.
But you would think that F-Zero X, Wave Race 64, Rocket Robot on wheels were all cool, but...
Yep.
Zelda needs to come first.
I agree. I'm happier with the list this way, but you got to give Brian credit for like just basically talking to try and make you forget that he put Mario 64.
Oh, is that what
he was doing? He's like, oh, I think about like, you know, like if would you like a cheeseburger instead? Like he just brought out everything for you.
I really did.
So you'd be confused and swap the wrestling game.
I know. We got to give credit to Jose for pretending like he wasn't actually going to do that all night, and then we knew he was going to. So.
I was a little nervous. I will say that. All right. Well, look. First of all, I want to thank you so much for helping us make this list. It's not easy, as the way Brian said, but also, you know, this usually ends up in a lot of arguments, and we're willing to listen to your arguments when we come back from an intermission. So we're going to take a quick 10-minute intermission, get some food, use the restroom, whatever you need to do, but we're going to come back, and when we do, it is a live question block for at least 15 to 20 minutes. You guys get to basically ask us anything about Nintendo, please, and that's about it. So let's go for a 10-minute break, and we'll be right back.
And remember, Marty Sliva, according to IGN, Mario 64 is better than Banjo-Kazooie.
Here we go!
Okay, so if you listen to Nintendo Voice Chat, you know we have a segment called The Question Block, which is near and dear to my heart, so much that I forget to put it on several episodes, but you're getting a live one right here. So how are we going to decide how to get people up here, though? Because we're not doing more raffle prizes. There's one more raffle at the end that Brian's going to do, but it's for the last statue up there.
I feel like we need a mic assistant.
A roaming mic assistant. Is there a brave enough person at IGN who will take on this task?
Winston?
A roaming,
I'll make one of my kids do it.
It's Winston. Hi, everyone. Right. Say hi, Winston. Really loud.
Hi, Winston.
Hi, Winston. Hi, guys.
Louder than that. Hi, Winston.
Hi, Winston.
All right. Raise your hand if you have a question, and Winston will find you and give you the mic. Introduce yourself. Say your name. Stand up, just so we can see you.
Hey, I'm Varun.
All right.
I'm
nice to meet you, Varun.
Listener. I absolutely love the show. But my big question is, what is Retro Studios working on? I know, like Sam, I'm a big fan of Metroid Prime, and I so dearly want them to make another Metroid game.
What are they working on? Donkey Kong. I think, I think they're definitely making another Donkey Kong game, or Donkey Kong Country, for the next console. Like, it's just, those sell well, and there are... I don't want to say they're easy to make, but it's something they have gotten in the groove. They know how to pull them off, and they maybe the size of the team that works on shrinking over time too, right? They're getting more optimized. And then I don't think they're going back to Metroid yet. I think Nintendo's gonna either find a new developer or go in-house with the next Metroid game, and I think Retro is gonna have a new brand for us, a new franchise.
What's exciting and sad is that team is working on, well, the team that made Metroid is split up to a bunch of different companies now, and there's games like ReCore, which has people on it.
Halo had a few people on it. Yeah.
So the rumor mill says that Retro is working on a new IP with a different producer. Meaning, let me set that the table for folks. In the past, Donkey Kong Country Returns, Tropical Freeze, and even the Prime games were all done under the same Nintendo side producer, Kensuke Tanabe. The word on the street is the game that Retro is working on is not involving him, but someone else. That's all we really know, sadly. So that is a really well-kept secret. It's most likely an NX game. I mean, I would be surprised if it was not an NX game, to be honest.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, that's it. Sometimes secrets are just kept very well. Like, what is NX? No one really knows. Every other day, a patent comes out and people go crazy. It's a bottle of water. It's shaped like they'll point to any quote and anything to kind of like put together what it is. And it's sad. Just we gotta wait and see, you know?
I'm eagerly awaiting.
Same.
As are we.
Yeah. Super
but there's excited. A Metroid game coming out in just a few weeks.
Please. You just did more promo for that game than Nintendo has.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, thank you very much.
Thanks, man.
All right, Winston. Winston's on the prowl. All right.
Hi.
Say your name.
Is that a Corgi Doug, in a right? Captain America outfit?
All right. Say your name anyway for the folks
That's
at home.
Amazing.
Hi, my name is Doug.
Hey, Doug.
How's it going? First, hey, I got you guys succulents.
Oh, what? Tribute! Tribute!
Thank
we got,
you.
Really? We got something. What? What you got?
Oh my god, that's awesome. You got some little plants.
Hens and chicks.
Oh, that's
this
cool.
This one says Pears Bulbasaur, level 15.
Wow.
Oh, these are so great.
Jose's nice Doug Trio, level 29.
Problem. That's beautiful.
That's
you
awesome.
Didn't know you were going to be here, Sam.
Okay. Wait, Brian's Marlboro? You know
you
I don't smoke anymore, right?
But Sam. Sam, did you know
thanks,
you can
man.
Split these?
I know, you
can
give me a cutting.
And you can grow new ones.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
So my question is, if you weren't in games media, what would you be doing?
Oh, I know.
Astronaut or locomotive driver, probably.
Locomotive driver?
Yeah, like trains.
Do you know, like, at the San Francisco Zoo, is so weird. Really?
No, of course not.
Per Schneider, age 5.
I'd love to run a restaurant, but I hear it's really difficult.
Yeah,
that's a dream job. That would have been awesome.
Yeah,
it is. Yeah. Peter says it's hard.
This
yeah.
is so cool. Yeah. Thank
Sam,
you.
What would you do?
What would you do?
Well, people might know I'm into classic arcades and restoration. I would like to do, you know, restoration or curation of a museum.
That's very nice.
I like it. Brian?
I would probably do podcasting of some kind. Like, I would just talk.
But you already do that.
Well, I mean, I just AM radio. Talk about video
you
games.
Can't say my dream job is to do exactly what I do. What else could you
to do?
Do
my
no,
other
no,
job.
Just that.
I guess I would probably focus on music, work on a lot more music stuff, have more time for that. Cooking I'm really into. Cooking's awesome. Like, it's one of the only times you're not staring at a screen. Literally, as a human being on planet Earth in 2016, it's nice to be in your kitchen. Unless you're looking at a recipe on a screen, then you're screwed. But yeah, I think something like that.
You could be a comedian. Or an air hostess in
it's,
the 60s.
People have asked me to do that, like get up in front of a brick wall and tell jokes, and I'd rather just, I like being off the cuff. I like being sort of just like this. So this is more fun for me.
Okay.
What about you, Jose?
So I think deep in my heart, I would still be teaching. So if you don't know, I used to be a math teacher in the Bronx in New York City, and I taught math. 9th and 10th grade. I probably could have taught half of this room, actually, because you guys are roughly, a lot of you are the age of my students today. And it was just really fun. Like, there's something magical about selling an idea to a group of kids, getting them to understand a concept, and seeing them get it. And it's also every bit as dramatic and sad when you see them not get it, you know? And it's that constant struggle of trying to just show them opportunities and show them things that they can do. And I kind of miss it, quite honestly, but this was something I wanted to do for me, whereas that job was very much about doing things for them.
Right.
Yeah.
I think it's amazing that you and I are friends, because when I was in 9th and 10th grade, math teachers were like my worst enemies.
Oh, yeah. No, I designed my class for kids who hated math. Like, the outlook first day of class was, this is the math class for kids who don't like math. And I promise you, you will walk out of here enjoying this, or
so
I hope.
If I had gotten left back enough and moved to the Bronx, I would have been in your class.
Yeah,
so
no,
did,
that's true.
Did you do things that were, like, my math teachers were always, like, they seemed to, like, have come from a different century. Like, they did not know what was popular in pop culture. Did you use, like, your knowledge of games and stuff?
Yeah, the games, videos, trailers, whatever I could. My homeroom was the banging his homeroom at our school because not just because like we had all the technology.
It was full of all your favorite 90s rap slang.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. No, it was such
word
an
is bond.
Awesome. Yeah, word was bond in that class. No, I remember my homeroom kids, and especially when they gave me all the cool technology because I was the young, cool, hip math teacher. So yeah. I was like, hey, let's give him a projector and a smart board and all this stuff. We'd be playing games or talking about him, and yeah, I just wanted to. I don't know. For me, it was always just showing them that they don't have to grow up that fast, number one. And then number two, to be realistic and find things that they want to do. And I'm choking up a little, so we need to move on. All right, so next question. Raise your hand, please. Nice and high. Winston's getting around.
Hello.
He promises to go past the first row on the next question. Great. All right.
Hey, I'm Aaron.
Your name?
Aaron.
Hey,
hi, Aaron.
Aaron. What's up, man?
How's it going? Jose, I have to say, I'm right there with you. I teach at the college level, too, so I have that feeling strong in my heart.
Nice.
So,
good for you.
Yeah.
Good for you. Thank you for doing that.
Yeah. Everyone. No, for sure.
I feel bad now that I don't have a personal question, but this is more of a
Nintendo
one.
Don't ask personal questions. I can't do it.
All right. So we see there's a lot of talk about NX coming out, and it's all just covered in miasma, mysterious what's happening. What do you guys think is going to happen with the next generation of the handheld? So I think almost everyone in here has a 3DS.
Yeah.
So it has some pretty strong penetration, but I've heard nothing about what's coming next for their handheld side. And Nintendo just yesterday sort of jumped into this mobile market with Pokemon Go. So what do you think all that is going to look like a year, two, 3 years from now?
It's going to be gone. What? I mean, it's sad to say, right? Like, I love my 3DS. I have a Vita at home, I have a PSP at home, all that. I have an Engage at home, which
it's your phone,
which you can't play.
You can't call Pear without calling him on his Engage.
Like it's you know the phones have gaming on a phone has become so convenient that you don't even think about bringing a device along. And like we got to realize, like I think the people in this room are special. We're special, right? When we plan a trip, we say I'm going to charge my 3DS. I'm going to bring it. But a lot of people don't want to take that step anymore. And so I think if the NX is a combination of a portable device and a home console device in some way, I think that's it for portable gaming.
Yeah, Nintendo said they want to take mobile games and make those like a taste of what you can play on a handheld or a console.
Right,
and if they combined a handheld and a console, then they only really have to have those test market games, like for people get just a taste of Mario Brothers, and then they can have them play their console slash handheld.
See,
I think they have to just combine those.
I disagree with Pear. I think there's one more dedicated Nintendo handheld left, and then we'll see
the
where
NX.
Things go
it's
from
It's called
there.
The NX.
Well, maybe, but I think there's something, right? And it's I don't know if it's the NX or it's the 4DS or whatever that we're calling it. But
4DS.
I don't think
four screens.
I don't think we're giving up just yet on handhelds.
I'm
like oddly more in love with my 3DS than I ever have been before. Like I have weird renaissances with that system where I won't touch it for a little while and then I'll come back and I'll be like, this is actually one of my favorite systems of all time. Mm. It's got like 8 or 9 of my favorite Zelda games ever on it. Like maybe 7 or 8 of my favorite Mario games ever. There's something special about all that, and the implication of actually holding an iPhone and using it to play really anything that Nintendo's ever made doesn't usually work yet. So I think there's still life left in the handheld world.
I'm not loving a button and stickless future for handheld gaming either. I think we're losing something there for sure. I actually think there is a play for handheld gaming to play to the nostalgia factor, right? We don't know what other technologies are slumbering out there, but we know what's in the past. If Nintendo released a Game Boy for $10, it would sell like crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Like, if you got this kind of nostalgia cool device.
So I'm going to say...
Actually, I made my phone look like a Game Boy for $8,
yeah,
which is
you totally did. So I'm going to say the answer to your question depends on what NX is, quite honestly, right? Because if it is this fantasy of... And I say fantasy, but I mean that loosely, right? But the idea of bringing together the handheld and the home console team to make a device that somehow combines the two, I just still think that's expensive. But at the same time, Nintendo's biggest successes and the things that are keeping them afloat today are, in fact, portable games. Last year, I forget because we're up here on stage and my mind's a little hazy, but when Smash Brothers 3DS came out, it was proof that that game, first of all, outsold the Wii U version by a magnitude that most people didn't even think was possible, right? But it was also a great example of what Nintendo can do when they try to put it on a portable system. Now, don't get me wrong, it wasn't the best experience in the world. Like, your hands would cramp up and the size of a smaller portable was difficult, but then, okay, look at other successes that are big portable games for Nintendo. Pokemon, mm-hmm. Yo-Kai Watch, which is from an outside partner, but still an important game. Monster Hunter, that is the game that, had the Vita gotten that game, it probably would be doing a lot better right now.
Yeah, totally.
That was a snatch and grab by Nintendo, and a smart one that gained a lot of foothold for them in Japan.
And I think handhelds play into their, they just talked about recently, they did an interview about their development costs, right? Talking about how much it costs to work in HD, to work on consoles. It plays into their strengths, not only with the sort of general art style that Nintendo's been running with for years, which is kind of like cartoony and fun and easily accessible. It's not really like completely realistic. That's not really their thing. That works perfectly on handhelds. 2D platformers work perfectly on handhelds. Top-down games. A lot of the things that they've been awesome at for decades now. Yeah. Sell well, play well.
Plus Mario Kart, plus yep. Animal Crossing, yep. plus Fire Emblem Fates. Like, the list goes on and on. And I just think it would be foolish for Nintendo to bet all that on the smartphone market, mm-hmm. which the device just doesn't quite fit what we expect those games to be.
I agree.
So it's a difficult situation to be in. So I think it really depends on what NX is, and if there is a future where there is a portable that somehow supports that ecosystem that they're trying to create. Cool, great question,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, next question. Winston is hovering, he's around.
He's running through the back. He's running wide.
And he's
going wide. He's coming back.
And he's going up, and he's going to find... there she is. Stand up, please.
Oh, no. Can't see you.
Hey, what's up?
Hi. Hi, I'm Sarah.
Hi, Sarah.
Hi, Sarah.
Thanks for coming on our show.
I'm on the podcast. I'm sorry about what happened in Germany today, Pierre.
Yeah. What happened in Germany?
I'm so sorry.
Soccer.
They lost. Oh.
I will always have this plant.
I wanted to ask you guys, because it's probably one of my favorite segments you have on your podcast, your hype about amiibos. So I was wondering, if you guys could design an amiibo for yourself, what would it be?
Oh, wait, like based on ourselves?
No,
or just
no,
a general character?
Anything you can make for yourself.
Anything.
Yeah. Thank you for that question. That's a good question.
That's a really good question. Yeah. I have to think about that. So
thank you so much, Sarah.
My immediate answer would be, like, I feel like the Samus amiibo I got was not the one I wanted.
Right.
I feel like there's more life left in the Metroid franchise for great amiibo, including a freaking Metroid one, right? Like a hovering one, maybe on a see-through stand. And then The Legend of Zelda is just full of these great characters, right? Like a standalone Midna that's beautifully painted would be really cool, or any of the kind of the secondary characters from that franchise would be really cool. Like, I would love the Mask Salesman from Majora's Mask. That'd be
ooh, that's
kick-ass.
A good one.
You know how they made the Mario that was in the 8-bit style?
Yeah.
I would love the Fat Link, like the short little fat
guy
with the sword sticking out like 1 inch.
Oh, that's really cool. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
One of the things I don't think they've done a lot with amiibo is played with scale in terms of, like, here's a boss fight, right? Like, mm-hmm. you have a tiny Mario, a gigantic Bowser. You have a small Link, a gigantic Ganon. You don't really have two characters on many amiibo. Like,
uh-huh.
that doesn't happen a ton.
So I think Rosalina something like that. Rosalina and the Star.
Yeah, or like the raccoon children that run that sweatshop that Tom Nook owns in Animal Crossing. You know who I'm talking about.
Yep.
Timmy and Tommy, I see you out there putting in that hustle, trying to leave in the middle of the night.
Putting in that hustle.
He won't let you leave because the store's open 24 hours. I know what's going on over there. It's illegal. So I think they should do something where you play with the scale and have a boss battle, like something very intense. Disney Infinity did that really well, where it was just like their characters were in action, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like you had Darth Vader, he had the hand out, he was about to do something. A lot of amiibo poses are very static. It's a guy,
especially the first run. The first run was painful.
They're just
static.
Standing and waiting for something.
But they got better at making them. But going
get
with
a
the
classic
Smash
boss
Bros.
Battle, like do Punch Out amiibo and have Little Mac this big and. Not Mike
King
Tyson.
Hippo.
The other guy. That big. King Hippo would be awesome.
You could have like Ridley from Metroid 2 and a tiny Samus.
That's
in front
what I'm talking
of
about.
A snow
That'd
globe.
Be really cool.
Snow globe.
Yes.
Snow globe.
Yeah.
Ooh. Man, I always find these kind of trying to come up with an answer for a question like this really tough, because I know what I want, but I know that Nintendo is always thinking about how is this going to scale for a market. And the product I want wouldn't scale to a kid's market, right? It would be something like, have you guys seen like those Good Smile figures or like those are just very detailed, very like well-made figures from Japan? I would just love amiibo to try an experiment in that direction, to try something of premium quality, maybe charge a little more for it, frankly. But I think that if you target the right audience and the pose looks good, I'll take anything Zelda, quite frankly, even though we already have them and we're getting more. Like the Breath of the Wild ones look fantastic.
Yeah.
And if anything, like that's probably even the Guardian is the closest thing to the boss fight you're describing in a way.
Yeah, and they're breaking the conventions of what amiibos are because they're like posable and they're articulated.
In that one's case, absolutely. In the other two, not so much. But it's still just to me, like I would like to see something bigger. And I know it's not convenient. Wow. And I know it's not something that fits in a backpack or that a kid's going to take somewhere. But fun fact, they're not doing that right now.
Yeah.
And they can put it in a backpack.
See, I thought you would go for something like Box Boy or a character from Rhythm Heaven or something.
I would love a Box Boy.
Something Jose-ish.
Yeah, no.
I like that idea.
Those are good.
Box Boy, how do you do it? Like you have to print it on a clear.
Hey, they figured out the Game & Watch. They can do anything. Yeah. After you figure out
Rubik's
Game & Watch.
Rubik's Cube,
Box Boy.
Nice. All right, great question. Thanks,
good
Sarah.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
All right, awesome. Next question. Winston's on the prowl and he is looking and he is going to his left. All right.
How's it going, guys? It's Dee here. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, a little louder.
Where are you from?
I'm from Belfast, Northern Ireland.
Thanks for making the long trip.
Yeah, it was very long to get here tonight, so thanks for having me. I got to actually just talk about something quite sort of close to my heart. Going back to the top 10 list, because I almost couldn't sleep if I had ended a Mario Kart, or Mario 64 as number one. Brian, I got to say that was one of the best arguments I've ever heard for it being number one.
Thank you.
And Jose, I know you came running to the rescue with kind of your story of how it got you back into Nintendo. For me, that game actually, I used to go to my rental store back in Belfast. We didn't have Blockbuster, we called it Extravision. And I used to rent Mario Party 3 just repeatedly. I probably could have bought it four times over, but I just rented it all the time. So I did that, and one day they didn't have it. And the guy at the store said, you should check this game out, Zelda. And I'd never heard of Zelda, I had no idea what it was about. And I rented it and instantly had to go in and buy it instantly. And when I got the first three stones at the start, the spirit stones, I thought that was the end of the game.
Yeah,
and I was
too.
So satisfied with it being the end of the game. That was a great game. It lasted quite a long time. Mm-hmm. And then the twist came, and it totally blew my mind. So thank you, Jose, for putting that on the top of the list. There was one game, though, that wasn't in that list at all. And it's a different name for me. I call it Lilith Wars.
Star Fox 64.
Star Fox 64 over here, Lilith Wars for me. That game, like, I'd maybe put it in top kind of five or six for me. But what I really wanted to ask you guys was I picked up Star Fox Zero.
Yeah.
And I'm a huge Lilith Wars fan. I've got tons of the gear and caps and all sorts. That game really disappointed me. It just didn't meet the mark for me. It did in some ways, but in so many it didn't. And I just wanted to kind of know what your opinion of that game was and if you weren't satisfied, why maybe that was.
Sure.
It's an interesting one. Did you review it?
I did review it.
So you enjoyed it a little more than we did, right?
I did, yeah.
And I went back and forth on that title. Like there were these moments where I'm like, man, this is so cool. And then I'm like, I wish the controls felt like the old games. And it wasn't, it's kind of, like I felt like, am I being boring? Like, do I just want the same thing over and over? I've already played Star Fox games before.
I was exactly the same. And what I was wondering as well was that I couldn't tell if I got older, if the game hadn't aged well,
because
it was kind of doing the same things, but just wasn't the same. And I never really figured out why.
I think the reason Star Fox as a franchise always succeeded was because it felt like a really cool roller coaster. And the great things about roller coasters is that you don't have too much to think about, and you can focus on how exhilarating the experience is. Whereas Star Fox for Wii U all of a sudden became something where you were constantly micromanaging it, babysitting it almost, and checking in and making sure everything is okay. Yeah. And for some people who are into sort of a lot deeper games like that, I think it worked out, and it clicked really well with Jose, who's totally able to manage those systems. When I get home from a long day, I want to be on a roller coaster. I want to sit down in a chair, hold up something, and just play through it.
Sure.
And that's where it kind of lost me, and I think there's a really great game in there.
Yeah.
There really is, and there's a lot of really cool stuff, and it's got a lot of really good ideas, but ultimately, it kept breaking the sort of synchronicity that I had with that game.
And you know why?
And the controls were asking too much.
Yes.
I mean, they honestly were, and it was something that, even though I ended up going in the good category, I think, on IGN, so it's in sevens.
Yeah.
Sorry if I don't remember off the top of my head. But I think the thing that saved it for me is I did find pockets of that roller coaster. I liked the boss fights a lot, and I just hit this rhythm where once I got it down, I felt really good at it. And enjoyed it, and it did have. But I think part of the problem too is that Star Fox hasn't changed much.
Yeah.
And it was something that I don't think I said then that I would say now is that maybe sticking so closely to 64 and this idea that was, 1997?
Yeah.
When that game came out, quite frankly. don't get me wrong, nostalgia is a great thing. 90s nostalgia is especially in, but there is something to be said for doing something where you're pulling the idea forward, but at the same time still retaining what keeps it special. I'm not saying redesign Star Fox from top to bottom, because I don't think that would work, but I do think that smart entertainment finds a way to balance it right. And I think when you have something that's still kind of doing the same jokes, but is also trying this ambitious control scheme that's asking a lot of you, you're setting up a recipe where people aren't going to be as satisfied.
I kept on thinking of Star Wars. First of all, there was a great game called X-Wing back in the days that did something very special in the kind of like in the third dimension with spaceships, right? Like you flew past convoys, you had to check whether they're smuggling something, you had to do all these different missions. But like, I remember the feeling of watching the original Star Wars and that end trench run, right?
Yeah.
Luke does not use the target computer. And Star Fox does all the time. And that was the issue. It's like, I love seeing the trench and the speed of everything going by, but Star Fox always goes, but no, look over here now, right? Like, and I think that took you out of it. There was this kind of fussiness about zooming in on the spiders going up the tower instead of just letting me fly away, come back, and shoot them down and just telling me that they're there, right?
Yeah.
That said, I think there are a bunch of missions, like when you're stopping the missiles, that are really exciting, or when you like, I mean, I started sweating when those bastard little droids were attacking, you know, the great fox.
What
like,
about, what
there's
about,
some good moments
what about
in that
the
game.
Dogfights? I thought the dogfights and Z-targeting and using the dogfighting was smart.
But
and
again,
I think
like,
that was one of that game's probably its best successes.
But we have all played space games like EVE in VR now, where like a dogfight takes on a completely different, like this immersion level is so great where you're sitting in a cockpit and when somebody flies past you, all you have to do is follow them with your eyes. You actually look and you can see
if
them.
If you don't
and
throw
Star
up.
Fox, Star Fox couldn't do it, yeah, unless you
if
had
you
sick.
Don't hurl,
that's
yeah,
true.
But that's the other part of it, right?
Yeah.
It's asking a lot of you as well.
But I feel like, I mean, this comes across as maybe a little bit too negative. Like, I still had a lot of fun with that game and found a lot of good things in that game. But like, yeah, some of that spark is gone.
Sam, anything to add?
No. I mean, you're totally right, though, coming out of playing all these Oculus and Vive games in VR, and you're seeing the future of space shooters. Well, that's what Star Fox was at one point.
Yeah.
It was the future of space shooters. It was a 3D polygon awesome shooter that was, like, cutting edge. The latest Star Fox felt like a throwback to me. It's not cutting edge anymore, and I feel like my space shooters have to be gorgeous and new and graphically intensive, and it just wasn't.
It needs a Zelda redo, right? Like Breath of the Wild does something very different. If somebody approached Star Fox that way, it could be really cool.
Right,
yep,
that's exactly it.
All right, we got time for two more questions, so raise your hand and Winston will find you. And he is walking around right now. Hey.
My name's Peter, and
hey, Peter.
You guys probably all remember me from all the up at noon attendance.
Hey, Peter.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've seen you, Peter.
Yeah, and my question is about Legend of Zelda. Yeah, I asked Peter about this earlier, and I'd like to ask the rest of you about it. Yeah, in 2001, Legend of Zelda released their first ever two-part adventure, which was Oracle of Ages and Seasons. And
yeah.
Which was a really fun adventure, and
that's right.
I was wondering, wouldn't it be fun to have another two-part adventure?
Sort of like that for the Zelda series.
Games like Pokemon having two editions of a similar game. Although the you know those Zelda games were actually very different, not like Pokemon.
Yeah, but there was something really smart about playing one to then get a code and put it into the other game to then get a different type of experience. It was sort of following different, slightly different rules.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it was a cool experiment.
I'll actually kind of piggyback on that and say that the original Legend of Zelda is actually one of the first Zelda games to have a two-part adventure. Because you could play through the entire game and then input your name as Zelda and replay the entire game in a completely remixed fashion. Which I think, like, if you think about the way Breath of the Wild is laid out, there's kind of potential for that. It's a completely open world game that you can play out of order, which is mimicking the original Zelda more than ever. It'd be really cool if when you finish that game, they just rearrange the hidden dungeons and open world areas and weapons and stuff like that and items. And all of a sudden you went back in and you're like, I'm playing the same game again, but everything's in different places. And it's kind of like getting two games for the same price. The original Legend of Zelda, when you finished it and you started it over again, it was like, well, I'm a kid and I can't afford a new video game, but I kind of have a sequel to Zelda in this game right here. So it'd be really cool to see if Breath of the Wild could do that again.
Or if they try something like that even with DLC, right?
Yeah.
Like come up with a way to insert something that wasn't there before that you can stumble upon Master and Quest sort of play. Yeah.
Remember, I mean, the original concept for the 64DD version of Ocarina of Time was that you would replay the game and everything's remixed, every enemy is placed differently. And we got a version of that game without the 64DD later as Master Quest. I love that concept of kind of a remix OODA Zelda, kind of like different Zelda game. I just, you know, I think the old kind of flagship Capcom Game Boy Zelda model, they're never going to replicate that because it was so much work to create two different games.
They're going to make three.
Think
it'll be more work
and
now.
I don't think they sold twice as well just because they came out together, right? Like, I feel like that model
well,
they tried.
Well, it was pitched as three games and then one got taken away. Don't
one
forget.
One went away.
Yeah,
right.
But, I did like that idea, and I wonder if, as Aonuma is experimenting with the series constantly, if he'll find a way to tinker with a standalone Zelda that will somehow still break apart into two very different experiences. But not necessarily charge you for it. Like, I think Fire Emblem Fates is a good example of one way to do that.
Oh, yeah.
To an extent, right? Like, have two sides of a story, and you're exploring it. But in that example, you're paying, and I they'd have to make it worth it, I feel. Where
can
in Fire
you, can
Emblem
you think
Fates
of another Zelda game that came out on the same day as another Zelda game, and they're very different?
Twilight
Princess on Wii and GameCube.
Those are actually 2 weeks apart, but yeah.
Yeah,
they were flipped
roughly the same
flipped
way. Flipped
without motion controls.
Yeah.
We could get that.
Probably
get two versions of the Zelda, right?
Yeah, that's a very cheap. If they like sold Breath of the Wild and then 2 weeks later they're like, here's Breath of the Wild Mirror Mode, $60, I'd be like, hey man, I'm not doing this.
Well, and that's the thing, right? Like, you're not playing Hero Mode in Breath of the Wild, because you know what's Hero Mode? Like, running around in shorts and doing everything.
Yeah.
Like, you just don't put clothes on, and you're at a much higher risk of getting killed in that game. but, yeah, I think we've all kind of hit the answer, and thanks, Peter, for the question.
Yeah.
So this is our last question. Winston, it's all
Where's
on you.
Where's Winston?
He's over on the left side of the
Winston,
room.
Winston, man, don't pick
don't
the wrong
be
person
shy.
Now, like... This has got to be good.
This is it. Pressure.
They're only right people.
All right. Stand up, please. And your name, sir?
Alex.
Alex.
Hey,
what's
Alex.
Going on, man?
So thank you for the show. I really appreciate my daily commute with your voice.
Thank
and
you.
And I just wanted to ask a question that sort of segue to a previous question. So there has been a lot of talk throughout E3 that the Zelda Breath of the Wild is the last hurrah for Wii U. So do you think Pokemon Sun and Moon will be the last hurrah for the 3DS? If you can make one more game for 3DS, what would it be?
Ooh, okay. So I'm going to take the first half of the question to give you guys time to think. Is that cool?
Yeah,
okay.
Go ahead.
So I don't think Pokemon Sun and Moon is the last hurrah for 3DS. I think that Nintendo will still continue to support that platform because it is a high install base, and it is a platform where they can make a quality game that's going to sell really well. I mean, Sun and Moon... I hate to call this shot early, but it totally makes sense that Christmas is going to be much better for Nintendo this year than it was last year because there's a big game like a Pokemon coming
right.
out, the new generation of Pokemon at that. And I don't think you just ignore that, especially when you have to define what NX is and hope people will buy it.
Yeah, I agree with you. Like, they're being very quiet on the future of 3DS software right now, but we've seen that happen before, you know, when... especially when they're cramming away on games for a new console, you know, with the NX launch coming. But I gotta think that there are a couple of major franchise installments still coming for the 3DS. You know, like we've seen a great Zelda game on the 3DS. We've seen a fun multiplayer Zelda game. I feel like it's time for another great single-player adventure on that platform, and I don't think we're done. And then same with Mario, you know. I don't think we've
World
seen.
2.
I don't think we've seen cool. all Mario can offer on that platform either.
Especially when 3D Land got it so right. I mean, I feel like that was
right.
a really smart portable game in the style of Galaxy, but not turning the camera and you upside down.
Well, we haven't had like a really dedicated 2D side-scrolling Mario game in a very long time now.
Yeah, new Super Mario Bros. 2. I really like that. I like the coin swap that they did. Like, where you collect coins a lot. Like, that would be a great new variation on 2D Mario.
Yeah, and there was a while there where we were, like, getting burnt out of those games because they were coming out every 6 months, and then they put out, like, Super Luigi, and all of a sudden we're like, well, now it's been, like, years and years since we've had one of those, and I kind of miss... when they happened all the time. It's kind of like the 2D Castlevanias or the 2D Metroid games where they happened for so long and then they just stopped and you're like, bring them back. But I think Nintendo, it's the way they put their things together, they're sort of like, it's like they're cooking a big meal and they're focusing on a main course, but they're also like cooking some side dishes on the side. And sometimes the side dishes are like, well, it doesn't look like you put a lot of thought on this, but other times you're like, These Brussels sprouts are amazing. Where'd you get this recipe? So out of nowhere, the Brussels sprouts might be better than the chicken that they made, but you're like, I didn't think that would be
making me hungry. Stop it.
Yeah. I'm sorry, guys. Yeah. So I think that they still have surprises. They still have side dishes. They're going to be focusing on NX, but there's still going to be some stuff that's on the table that's going
to
be really good.
So I would propose a game then to answer the second half of the question,
okay,
just to get you guys started. I want a Metroid game. Yeah. I want a 2.5D Metroid game.
Yeah.
I want that
I got
on
some
a
good
handheld.
News for you in a couple weeks.
Yeah, I
know. Stop it.
No, I'm really happy that Super Metroid is on new 3DS Virtual Console, right? Like, that's a cool thing for me as someone who upgraded. There are plenty of people who didn't, and that's fine. If you're going to use that as a reason to move up, why not? 3DS is going to be around. Is going to be around a while, in my opinion.
Good
but
God.
Something new would be great, and someone, you know, just. Internally at Nintendo, there have to be people championing.
It's pretty crazy. I mean, like, the Konami and Nintendo were the masters at cranking out these wonderful 2D games with Metroid, with Castlevania, and they've kind of disappeared, which is a real pity.
But Konami cranked out more.
Yeah.
Nintendo, every Metroid was, oh, okay, Fusion here,
yeah,
Zero
yeah.
Mission here, okay,
but
Silence.
But there was a good run. Now, yeah. You know, I just played Inside on the Xbox One, and I just can't stop thinking about, like, what if you give that developer a 2D Metroid game, like, with that kind of visual style and stuff.
No kidding.
I want one. But I agree, that would be an awesome 3DS game. We keep on asking Nintendo questions about Pikmin 4, and I've wondered, like, what if Pikmin 4 is actually a 3DS game rather than a console game?
It'd be
right?
really hard to see where you're flinging Pikmin.
Yeah, but think about it. You have two screens. You have the kind of zoomed-in view where you see your Pikmin, and then you have your, like, tactical kind of, you know, like, general's overview of the battlefield and where you're sending your Pikmin. It could be really cool to
see. It could be, and I agree. Sam?
I mean, you got to keep in mind that... Oh, sorry, not to cut you off, but you have to keep in mind that we got a top-down Zelda game in the last year.
Yeah.
You know?
We've gotten two.
Yeah.
Triforce Heroes and... I mean, before that, not in the last year, but A Link Between Worlds is the other one.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think there's still room for experiments like that.
Yep. Okay, fair enough. No, that's good.
No, I had already mentioned Super Mario Land 2 or World 2, which would be really cool, but I played Bloodstained at E3, the new
Castlevania
game from Shiga,
yeah.
And it's Castlevania. It's just exactly Castlevania. There's just nothing changed except for the name, and it made me so happy, but I don't want to sit in my living room and play that. I want to play that on my 3DS, so
right.
A port of that would be awesome,
yeah.
Or a sequel to that, or just maybe a Castlevania game, although this is as good or better than any recent Castlevania game. Yeah. So,
you guys have any other examples? I have one more.
What do you got for it?
I mean, F-Zero. F-Zero is the other, like, sort of, like, missing Nintendo franchise.
For 3DS?
For 3DS. It may be too fast, I will agree, but Mario Kart 7 proved that a racing game can do well. It is a kart racer, so the rules are different. Not quite as brutal, especially if you think about, what, F-Zero GX, which... hated you, your friends, their family. Like, that game was hard.
Yeah, see, I don't think we'll get an F-Zero on 3DS because Mario Kart sold too well, right? Like, the level of effort, the level of effort in making these two games is almost even, but the sales difference is 2 million units, right? And like that's where I feel like Nintendo will always opt for, hey, you know what? It's time for another Mario Kart for the 3DS rather than going to the F-Zero well again.
I would be surprised if you go to the Mario Kart on 3DS well again, only because that one sold so well and you can easily just wait until you do an NX version or something like that. But you need an install base for that. That's a fair point.
Yeah.
Totally fair point. Maybe Mario Kart 9 is a 3DS game.
I would love another F-Zero. Yeah. I mean, it's been so long, right? Like, the last F-Zero we really got, the console F-Zero was Amusement Vision. The Sega studio made it.
Yep.
F-Zero GX and then AX in the arcades.
Sure.
And that was amazing. That was such a good game. They figured out the right partner to go to build a game like that. And I wonder, you know, a lot of people who worked on fantastic rally racers and amazing racing games are out of a job because a lot of studios like Eden, right, shut down. I feel like that'd be a good move to find an external studio to really carry that mantle.
Let's not forget, though, I mean, Mario Kart 7 was designed by Nintendo Japan, but Retro made those courses.
Yeah,
like, they were also pretty busy and decided, hey, let's just throw Retro at this to kind of put this together. It ended up looking great.
And Namco made Smash Brothers, right? Like, they are going with more partner studios for the stuff. So they should be able to make more games.
All right.
I want more.
Well, I wish we had more time, but we are out of it, sadly. I want to thank you very much for coming tonight. We really appreciate it again. Like, this event came together at short notice, and yet here you are, and we're really happy to see you, and we're really happy that you guys came and joined us out here.
Listen!
So a lot of people worked really hard to put this show together, and I just want to take a quick second to acknowledge them. Kirsten Slater, Winston Shum, Alexio Quallarini, Sean Finnegan, Dave Toole, CJ Gibson, our panel up here, Sam Claiborne at the end, Per Schneider, Brian Altano. Thank you so much for coming to support us. We really appreciate it, and we will see you next time on Nintendo Way Chat.
Thank you.
Shout out to the giant red bucket.